We've just been through the recap of what we've been doing so far, and we are studying the harmony at the various levels. So now that we have finished the harmony in the human being, or at least we have understood the harmony in the human being, now we go on to harmony in the family, so that we can understand the harmony at all the levels. So this is just a brief what we are doing, the same process as what we've been doing so far, process of self-exploration. So we'll be putting forward the proposals before you, and you need to verify them on the basis of your natural acceptance. So we looked at some of these questions earlier. We explored, can we live in relationship without understanding relationship? And we had come to the conclusion that unless we have the right understanding about relationship, it is very difficult to fulfill relationship. So we are not able to. And that's why when we ask the question, the unhappiness in our families, is it more due to lack of physical facility or more due to lack of fulfillment in relationship? We were all able to see that despite the fact that we have sufficient physical facility, the major issue in our families today is that of relationship. Physical facility can only be used as a means, but the real problem is there in relationship. So why is this happening? We don't understand relationship. Why don't we understand relationship? What we are doing is we are considering the human being to be the body. So it's not possible to understand relationship, because we think we are the body. We are not aware of the self. And when we don't understand the relationship, obviously there is a problem. We can't fulfill the relationship. It doesn't work. So now we will look at relationship in the light of the fact that we are just not just the body, but we are a coexistence of the self and the body. So here is one statement before you. Relationship is, meaning the relationship is already there. Not that we have to create it. We are all, familiar with relationship within our family. We can see that we are related. We have, either as husband, wife, mother and child, father and child, parent and child, and so on. We have children. We are related to our parents and all that. So we'll take a reflection from you. Think about this. Relationship is between oneself and another self, or do you think relationship is between one body and another body? So just take a moment to think about this. What do you feel? Is relationship between oneself and another self, or is relationship between one body and another body? So we can see our relationship among our family members, the people that we live with in the house. Are we also related to others? Do we have relationships with others also? So if you think about this and enter the reflection point, and we'll see, we'll go forward from there. Because ultimately relationship is a very important issue, and we can see that it's causing so much unhappiness for us. So we really need to understand it properly. We really need to find out, have we understood relationship or not? You can see some results that, majority of you are able to see that the relationship is between oneself and another self. Yeah. Then we are making one more statement here, which is another proposal. There are feelings in relationship, in oneself for the other self. And here again, we'd like to take your reflection on this. What do you feel about this? Can we talk about these feelings with definiteness? What do you feel? Are these feelings definite? Can they be discussed with definiteness? Or do you feel that the feelings are abstract and we cannot really discuss them with any definiteness? So what is your view on this? For example, you know, when we say, if I say the word mother, it brings up certain feelings within you, just associated with that word. So similarly, you know, with other words that we use among our relatives and all. So you feel some feeling when some word like this is uttered about a person that you're related to. So what do you feel? Are these feelings definite? Can we really define them? Can we discuss them? Or do you feel that they are abstract and we really can't discuss them? They are something that, you know, we just feel, but we really can't define or talk about. So think about this and we'll see what everybody feels about this. Yeah, so, okay. The majority can see that the feelings, or they feel that they are definite and can be discussed. But some of you also feel that they are abstract. So let us see if we can define these feelings or not. Let us see. So we are making one more statement here. We are saying that these feelings can be recognized. They are definite. And there are 9 feelings. And further, when we fulfill these feelings and when we express them to the other and evaluate, you know, that the feelings have reached the other, then it can lead to mutual happiness. So when I ensure the feeling within me and then I express it to the other, first, when I ensure it, I have happiness, I am in harmony. Then when I express it to the other and I evaluate this with the other, then the other can also be happy. In that sense, it can lead to mutual happiness. So we've made these 4 statements here. Relationship is, it's already there between oneself and another self. We don't have to create this relationship. It's already there. And there are feelings in relationship. When we talk of relationship, we associate it with feelings. And these feelings are in the self, not in the body. These feelings are in oneself for the other self. And we can recognize these feelings. There are 9 definite feelings we can recognize. And when we fulfill these feelings, express them and evaluate them, it can lead to mutual happiness for myself and for the other person. So what are these feelings in relationship that we're talking about? So we've listed these 9 feelings here, starting from trust, which is the foundation value without which the relationship cannot go forward. Going on to respect, affection, care, guidance, reverence, glory, gratitude, and ultimately ending with love, which is the complete value. So we'll go through these feelings one by one. We'll see if we can define each of these feelings. We'll see if we can explain these. Because so many times these feelings lead, you know, to our happiness or unhappiness. So we need to understand each feeling and see, you know, how we relate to it. Now, these feelings that we have listed here, these are feelings that are naturally acceptable to us. Feelings that naturally seem normal for me or naturally seem right for me. So we'll take it one by one. We'll start with the feeling of trust. So we'll just check a few things. First of all, what is trust? So we need to find out what is trust. And then will trust be, would I have trust only for few persons or would I have for all people? will this trust be conditional or unconditional? Meaning, will I trust somebody only when certain conditions are met by them, only when they behave a certain way? Or will I trust somebody unconditionally, regardless of how they behave? And lastly, can we trust anybody in continuity? Can we maintain this trust throughout? Or sometimes we have trust and sometimes we don't trust. So again, we'll ask for your reflection on this. Yeah. So will trust be there for only few persons or for all? Will trust be conditional or unconditional? And can we trust anybody in continuity? So what do you feel about this? When you have trust, can you trust everybody, or you can only trust few people? Will it be conditional or unconditional? So will you trust based on a certain person's behavior, how they behave, how they act, what you have experienced about the person so far? Or will your trust be unconditional regardless of how they behave? What do you feel? So we use this word trust very frequently, but what exactly does it mean? So that we are trying to find out here. And whether I can maintain it throughout, whether I can have this feeling of trust in me that is never broken. Is it possible to do that? Yeah, so, okay, the majority says for few people, a small percentage are saying that we will have trust for all, and 2% can't say. When we look at the second question, will trust be conditional or unconditional? It's kind of split. So 50 some percent say it's conditional. It depends on the other person's behavior. And 40 some percent say it is unconditional. And then can we trust anybody in continuity? So here also there is some doubt. So let us look, let us explore further and see what really it involves. So what we are saying is that trust is to be assured. To be assured of what? To be assured that the other wants to make me happy and prosperous. To have this clarity that the other wants to do the right thing for me, wants to make me happy and prosperous. So this is the real definition of trust. So now what we'll do is we'll explore this feeling of trust between two people. So think of yourself as one person. So we are evaluating trust between you, that's one side, one person, and the person that is close to you that you want to evaluate your trust with, that you want to explore this feeling of trust with. So, somebody close to you in your family, it could be your spouse, it could be your parent, it could be your child, it could be a very close friend of yours. So we'll explore this feeling of trust between you and the other person. And this other person is whoever is close to you that you want to see whether, this feeling of trust is there or not. And we'll ask some very simple questions regarding this. So if we look at our natural acceptance, we are making some statements here. I want to make myself happy. So you are saying this for yourself. Do you want to make yourself happy? Do you want to make the other person happy? Then you are thinking of what the other person is like, the person that you are evaluating the trust for. The other wants to make herself or himself happy. And the other wants to make me happy. So these are four statements we are making. And we want you to reflect, take your time, reflect on these and see what answers you come to. So this is regarding the natural acceptance. So when you are looking at yourself, you ask yourself, do you want to make yourself happy always? So I want to make myself happy always. Yes, no, can't say. Then for yourself, you want to make the other person happy always? Yes, no, can't say. What is your, you know, innate desire? What is your natural acceptance? Do you want to do this? Then about the other person. The other wants to make himself or herself always happy, or the other wants to make the other wants to make himself or herself always happy, and the other one is that the other wants to make me happy, always happy. So what do you feel? This is going to evaluate our trust. This is going to help us explore the trust between ourselves and our close people that we are close to. So we say all these words, but do we look at, you know, what it means when we say trust? Yeah, so I want to make myself happy always. That's pretty clear. Most people do. Then when we say I want to make the other happy always, that's also pretty clear. Most people are comfortable with that. Then the other wants to make herself or himself happy. That's also pretty clear. 70 some percentage. The other wants to make me happy always. Here there is some doubt. So it's doubtful. So we'll just, you know, say, we'll put that down. So I want to make myself happy. We can put a tick mark. You all feel that. I want to make the other happy. That also seems pretty clear. The other wants to make herself or himself happy. That also the majority said it's okay. The other wants to make me happy. Here there is a doubt. Here there is a problem. So this was the four questions we talked about regarding our natural acceptance or our intention, what we intended, what we would like to happen. Now we will look at our ability. So this first set of questions was what I want to be. I want to make myself happy. I want to make the other happy. Now we will look at whether we are able to do that. So first statement is, I am able to make myself always happy. Second statement is, I am able to make the other always happy. And the other is the close relative that we are thinking about for evaluating this. Then the other is able to make herself or himself always happy. And the last statement, the other is able to make me always happy. And again, we'll take your reflections on this. What do you feel about this? So the first set of questions that we talked about was what we want, what is naturally acceptable to us. Now we are asking about our ability. Am I able to make myself always happy? Yes or no? Think about it. Don't be in a rush to answer. Am I always able to make myself happy, or am I happy sometimes, unhappy sometimes? I'm not able to make myself always happy.
I think we can take a note of the word always here.
Yes, yes. So am I able to make myself always happy? Yes or no, or can't say. Am I able to make the other always happy? Yes or no. Or sometimes I make the other person unhappy. the other is able to make herself or himself always happy? Does that happen? And then lastly, is the other able to make me always happy? So now we are looking at these four questions regarding our ability. The first set of questions was regarding what we want. Now the set of questions are we able to do what we wanted? Is it happening or not? So that is the question now. So this has to do with our ability. This has to do with our, you know, whether we are able to make this happen or not. These are questions that are very important to us because we are, you know, living with these people under one roof, and we spend so much time outdoors and so much time at the workplace. Sometimes we might forget to think about these things or talk to the other people about this. So now that lockdown is there and we have the time, we can explore into these things. In fact, we forgot to mention, we should have mentioned actually earlier, I forgot. But it's nice if you can have your family members also sort of be with you.
Gajendra sir mentioned it.
Acha, very nice. Very nice. Yeah. It's nicer that way when the immediate family can also be a part of this. Yeah, so I am able to make myself always happy. So 73% are able to, which is very good if you are able to. That's nice. I am able to make the other always happy. Here it is a little bit less. It's like midway. Then the other is able to make herself or himself always happy. Here also there is some doubt. And obviously if the other cannot make themselves happy, then it's difficult for them to make me happy also. So we'll put these reflections down. So you can consider this a tick if you felt that you are always able to make yourself happy. Generally, that is a question mark somewhat. Then I am able to make the other always happy. That also is a little doubtful. The other is able to make herself or himself always happy. There again, there was a doubt. And again, you know, if the other is not able to make themselves happy, they won't be able to make me happy also. So double question mark, you can say. So this has to do with our competence. So we asked these eight questions. The first four on the left side were to do with my intention, which is my natural acceptance. And these other four on the right side have to do with my ability and the other's ability. So has to do with our competence. So these are two things that we asked. Now, when you see this question mark at 4A, you know, if we can see our natural acceptance is to make the other happy, we are not able to see that the other also wants to make me happy. So why is that? Why, how come we have a doubt here? So this question mark has come from here. What happens is when we look at ourselves, if you see the first set of questions, if you look at 1A and 2A, I want to make myself happy. I want to make the other happy. This is very clear to me. So this is, I can see my natural acceptance. Now, when I'm thinking about the other person, am I looking at the natural acceptance? No, I am looking at their ability. And I see that the other is not able to make himself or herself always happy, and the other is not able to make me always happy. And this doubt on 4B, that the other is not able to make me happy, this doubt, I drag it from 4B and bring it here to 4A. And I say the other doesn't want to make me happy. And you can think about this. Does it happen with you sometimes? You know, like say you have a student that comes late to class or doesn't do an assignment on time, what do we say? Do we think that he wanted to do it, but he was not able to? Or do we say he didn't want to do the work? Or, you know, if I get a phone call, I'm not able to take it, I'm busy. Then I say, when I talk to them, I say, I was unable to take your call. But if I call that person and the other doesn't pick up the phone, then what do I say? I called, but you didn't pick up the phone. See the difference? So, you know, somewhere we see the ability of the other person and we put it in there, bring it as a doubt on intention. So when I take the example of a glass that breaks, you know, when it is in my hand, I say it broke by accident. But the same thing when it happens when the glass is in the other person's hand, I say you broke the glass. So there is a difference in how I'm saying it, right? When it happens with me, I say this glass broke by accident, meaning I didn't really want to do it. I didn't mean to do it, but it happened by accident. But when it happens with the other person, I don't say that. I said you broke the glass, meaning almost as if saying you wanted to break that glass. You broke the glass. So we can check whether that happens with us sometimes. Even if I make the same mistake 100 times, I don't doubt my intention because I say it happened by accident. So I make mistakes by accident. So when I say this, that I didn't mean to do it, it just happened by accident, then what does it give me this feeling that I am good, that I really wanted to do the right thing, it just happened. So when I say that I am good, will I make any effort to improve my own competence? Or will I just, keep going thinking that the problem is with the other person? I am good. Like, you know, as I'm a pediatrician and I work with children. So one time this family came to me. The family had, you know, husband, wife and two daughters. Two daughters were school going children. And I could see that there is some tension, you know. The father used to bring these daughters for the checkup and some tension seemed to be there in their house. So I just inquired a little bit, because to me, you know, it's the family as a whole. It's not just one person in the family. So it's not the child that you're checking. It's like the child is involved with the whole family. So when I asked the person, you know, is anything wrong? Then the father just blurted out with all kinds of problems with the wife, and you know, she doesn't take care of the children, this happens, that happens and all. So I asked, why don't all of you come together? You bring your wife also, let the children also come and we'll discuss. But they were not open to all four of them coming. So I tried to get them one by one so we can have a talk with each one. And interestingly, each person that I talked to separately, when I talked to the father, he said, oh, all the problems of the wife, you know, I try so hard, I do so much, but this is the problem. When I talked to the wife separately, she said, you know, I keep cooking, I do everything for the family, and the problem is with him. When I talked to the older daughter, then she said, they are just like this, they are always fighting. I am just waiting till, you know, I have just 1 or 2 years more. Once I go to college and I'll be out of the house, then I don't have to worry about all this. Just imagine. And then the younger girl, she was hardly 2-3 years younger to the older sister. And she said that, they are always fighting. And my elder sister also, she's so dominating. I'm fed up with everybody. So now just see, 4 people in the family, they all feel they are good. The problem is with the other. So this doubt on intention, this feeling that I am good, but the problem is with the other, that doesn't allow us to improve our own competence. So when I look at the other person, if the other makes a mistake even once, I start doubting the intention. I say that he makes the mistakes intentionally. So when I say this, I already have this feeling of opposition. So when I have a feeling of opposition, what's going to happen? I'm going to get irritated. I'm going to get angry. And then I say that the other person is bad. They just can't improve. So we can check, you know, in our own relationships within the family, outside the family, people who are employed with us, people at the workplace, you know, does this happen? Do we tend to do this sometimes? For an employee, you know, supposing they don't do the assigned work, we tell the employee, supposing even if we tell them 3-4 times, but he doesn't do the work, what do we say? Do we say that he is unable to do the work, or do we say he doesn't want to work? So there could be some good reason, but do we try to find out why the person didn't do the work? Actually, if you think, even, you know, if there is a thief, we think that the thief wants to steal. The thief is happy to get money and get things without working. But we need to really go and ask the thief, is he happy doing what he's doing? And we might be surprised to find out that even they are not happy about this, you know. Even a thief doesn't want the shadow of his work, what he does, to fall on his child. Even thieves, they try so hard to keep their children away from what they are doing, educate them, put them into good schools, and try to see that they get a good education and that they are not influenced by what the father is doing. So we have to keep exploring this and seeing, you know, where we stand and is there room for improvement in all of us. This doubt on intention, this is the major reason for any problem in relationship. Because when we don't understand that relationship, when we don't understand that the intention of the other is similar to the intention that I have, and we start doubting the intention, there itself, we've already created a feeling of opposition with the other. So how is the relationship going to move forward now? So, you know, something like...
I think we can take some questions here.
Sure.
Some people are raising their hands. So Dr. Malik Raj. Dr. Malik Raj. Dr. Nand Kumar. Regarding the content that is being discussed, if you have any question, Dr. Tamil.
Regarding trust, tell me. Anybody has.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hello, yes.
Yeah, I'm Tamil Shilu, madam.
Please go ahead.
Madam, the session was very nice, madam, because to lead a smooth life, we have to analyze all these things, but normally we are not doing that.
True, very so, true.
Yeah, so we have to do a micro-analysis for leading life, no? Because many relatives and my friends are struggling so much in this leading a good life, struggling for life and so on.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, we have to teach them at least to some extent all these concepts and other things, right?
Yeah, I think if we can see it for ourselves, then we can, you know, also impact others.
Yeah, as you said,
others.
First we have to be happy, then only we can make others.
True, very true. We can only give what we have.
Madam, yes,
very
madam.
Nice, yeah.
You are right, madam. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Anybody has any question on trust? I think some participants have raised hands. If it has to do with trust, we can take the question.
Hello, Didi.
Huh.
Amishu. Yeah, you can unmute and ask questions. Dr. Velumani, Dr. Malik Raj.
Yeah, good morning, madam. Your morning. Voice was very sweet and we were able to clearly perceive whatever you say. And we don't want to waste our time, ma'am. So I think everyone are at the other side, very calm and observing. So we are very happy, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Then maybe we should just go ahead. What do you say, Kumar Bhaiya?
We can take some more questions, Didi. Dr. Gopalakrishnan. Dr. Malik Raj has not spoken. Dr. Nand Kumar. Okay. I think the hands were raised earlier. So what we can do, we can take some fresh questions. Dr. Vandana Devi.
Yeah, good morning.
Morning.
Ma'am, really, your voice is very sweet and you speak very softly. May I know you have, it is a personal question I could say, you have been like this right from your childhood or over a period of time looking at your patients, you have become like this?
Oh, that I think I am the wrong person to ask. You should.
Oh my God.
But yeah, I mean, we keep exploring and I don't think I've ever focused on the quality of my voice like that. But yeah, we keep exploring and trying to become a better human being. That's all. But not so much about the voice part.
That's nice. Not only the voice, I would say. The way you speak. Very polite, I would say. Mm-hmm. Actually very good. I have to learn from you. Thank you.
I think we can, Didi, then go ahead.
Move forward, ma'am.
Myself, ma'am.
Yes, somebody sir. Has a question?
Dr. Nandan Kumar.
Yes, ma'am. Actually, you
yes,
said
please.
That we doubt others' intention. We never doubt our intention. Mm-hmm. Is it anything related mm-hmm. to the perception, ma'am?
Anything related to?
I would like to know whether it is related to perception.
Yeah, see, when I already have this perception that my intention is good. I am able to see my intention very clearly. But when I look at the other person, I am seeing not their intention, I am seeing what actually they are doing on the outside, the expression of that, you know, how okay. they are behaving with me. And on that basis, I am concluding something. So it is an assumption that I have made about them based on what I see. Or my experience, like for instance, you know, if somebody doesn't return money, supposing somebody borrows money from me and doesn't return it, they say that we'll give it to you after 1 week and doesn't return it.
Okay.
Now, then based on this experience, I have decided that the other person doesn't want to return my money. Do you see?
Yes.
So same thing could have happened with me and there may have been a good reason for it.
Okay.
But when I'm looking at the other person, I'm not able to see that something might have hindered that person from returning the money to me. And so I say that the other doesn't want to return this money to me.
So to change this, I think we have to change our perception. Is it correct, ma'am?
I would say that, you know, if I can see my intention.
Fine.
And the other person is similar to me, like, you know, I am the self, this natural acceptance, we already said it is the same in everybody. So if I have this natural acceptance, the other also has the same natural acceptance. So if I am able to see that, then whenever, whatever answer I get from my natural acceptance, I can see that the other will also get the same answer from their natural acceptance. Do you see what I'm saying?
Like empathy that we should try to understand in their position.
Yeah, I mean, a simple way empathy. Of saying it would be to look at it from the other person's perspective. Right?
No.
To put yourself in the other person's shoes, to see from the other person's perspective.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah, Didi. So we can move now.
Yeah. So I think this reflection is there for them. Yeah. So in relationship, I think I am right and the other is wrong. Or I know that I am wrong sometimes. That is one question. The other question is, where do I generally start from? Looking at my mistake first or looking at the other's mistake first? So the first question is, in my relationships, do I think that I am right and the other is wrong? Or do I know that I am also wrong sometimes? And where do I start? Am I looking at my mistake first, or am I looking at the other's mistake first? It might happen so many times, you know, that when we go home from work, we are tired, we had a bad day at work, we go home, we just sit in front of the TV and we don't talk to the family members. And if somebody comes and says something, we just shout at them. Sometimes it may happen. But what will I think? I will think, they don't understand. I had such a bad day. I can't help it. Some kind of response like this might come. But if the same thing had happened to us, what would we think? Look at this person. I have been doing all this all day for this person and he comes and shouts at me. So do we have that perspective from the other's side, or do we see mostly things from our side? And where do I start from? Am I looking at my mistakes, or am I looking to correct the other person first? That is something that we need to explore, and that is something that is required for all our relationships, for them to move forward, for us to have a better and more fulfilling relationship. We have to do this. So, okay, in the first question, I know I am also wrong sometimes. Majority can see that. And where do I generally start from? Looking at my mistake first. That's very good if we do that. That should help build better relationships. But we need to sincerely keep exploring this.
Dr. Sita Lakshmi wants to say something here.
Go ahead, please.
Ma'am, I've been teaching for almost 30 years, and I know a lot of psychology because I teach architectural design. Mm-hmm. So what I find is that the stronger a person's construction of the self is, the more difficult it will be for them to accept themselves. So, and I see that younger people are more willing to understand their own constructions as being false or maybe malleable and so on. But what I find is, personally, the older the people, for example, since I am in a position of authority, like say when some parents of students introduce themselves to me over the phone, they do not say so and so's parent. They say, they first introduce themselves, which they may be at a, I don't want to say hi or whatever. So the first thing for me, I react very fast, though I am in a kind of, I'm supposed to be more, what do you call it, subdued and all that because of my post, but I tend to get provoked. So I'll say, first you introduce who you are with reference to me. So I just want to know that how far are you successful in actually, let's say a person who has constructed themselves till 50 years old, they have a self-image of themselves. And a child or a teenager is some 15, 20. So what happens is that are people who have evolved or accumulated a construction of themselves, how much would they be willing to actually modify or introspect and do this? Because almost invariably, I've seen lots of people who introduce themselves first in terms of what they are to the external world, and then only to what is actually pertinent to the situation. So yeah. I am actually, kind of, I would say that understanding human psychology is such a burden for me, but it does not make me act better. I just want to know how you deal with it as a person, as someone saying your voice is very soft, you're very, and all that. To me, people who react actively, I feel I can react to them more. So I'm sure that you will have a strategy, or I'm curious about your experiences with regard to people who are older and who have a strong construction of themselves, and are they willing to change?
Okay. Okay, I'll answer this. See, the first question that you said, people who have this construction and they are not willing to change. What you're probably referring to is that older people have more set of preconditionings as compared to younger set of people. You know, the younger students may have less number of preconditionings as compared to an older person. Over time, they have accumulated more preconditionings. Now, here, the focus is on myself. So if I can see that the other has all these preconditionings, he doesn't have the right understanding. He's not able to, you know, see that this preconditioning is not important. What is important is to base your thoughts and your behavior on natural acceptance. If I can see that, then that opposition doesn't come in. I'll give you a personal example. Okay. This was, since you asked for experiences, this was the, you know, several years ago when I was coming home from work in the afternoon. My father-in-law was at home. Nobody else was there in the house. And the children were elsewhere. You know, one was at school in extra class and my husband was not there. He was in Kanpur. In my hometown, he was in his college those days. So I thought, you know, when I came home from work, now here I was lugging, what used to happen, let me just give you an idea of what used to happen. I used to be at work and although I used to say that the work time is till 1 o'clock and after that I need to wind up and go home for lunch. It used to almost never happen because a lot of times patients would come a little late, somebody would call me, and even that day somebody called and said, you know, I had been seeing patients. 1 o'clock we used to close appointments, supposedly. But by the time I actually finished, I used to take a lot of time with patients. So by the time I actually finished, it would be close to 2. Now somebody called me just before I left and said, please ma'am, wait, we are on the way. We really need to see you now. So I waited. I asked them how long it will take and they said some 10 minutes. So I thought, okay. And I needed to buy vegetables for my house for the week. So I thought after I see that patient, then I will buy the vegetables on my way home and go. But instead of the 10 minutes, they took close to 25 minutes. They didn't show up. Then I called them again. Then they said, we are in traffic. We are just there in 5 minutes. So another 5, 10, 15 minutes later, they came. So, you know, by the time I finished, it was between 3 and 3:30 sometime. And then I went to get the vegetables. So you can understand the state of mind that I was in. Get vegetables, then I bought vegetables. I came home. And when I come home, I, you know, I'm lugging all these bags of vegetables and I went up to the kitchen door and I found that it was closed. It was locked from inside. And the TV, I could hear loudly, so I could, you know, I could see that if I call out to my father-in-law, he won't be able to hear. So I went around to the other side. The front door was also locked. Then I went to the other side door, carrying all this stuff, all these bags. Finally, I, and it was hot. It was peak summer. It was this time only, May, something like that. And I went inside feeling hot, humid, sweating. And carrying all these bags. And my father-in-law was sitting under the fan watching TV. And he just looked at me and he said, oh, kahan kahan ho hai, bahut shopping kar li. Meaning, you've been roaming around. That's nice. Yeah. You've been shopping. So, you know, it just made me so upset that I thought, you know, I didn't say anything to him. I just kept quiet. But I was just in my mind. It was going on and on, you know. Look at this, I'm doing all this, I have to do all this, I need to do all this. And now look at, you know, as if I'm enjoying my life and doing all this. And all this was going on inside my head while I was putting the things in my fridge. And then suddenly it struck me, those days, you know, I was exploring, trying to ensure the right feelings in myself. So then it struck me that he doesn't really know what kind of day I had. And nobody asked me to bring vegetables now. If I mean, if I wanted, I could have, you know, brought the vegetables in the evening also after eating and taking rest. So I thought to myself, it's, you know, why am I blaming him for the way I feel? This is up to me. He doesn't know that. And it is my choice. How I feel is my choice. The moment I said all this to myself and the moment I thought that, you know, how does he know what I've been through? It just made me feel so comfortable. That whole feeling of anger and opposition and irritation just vanished. And then I was able to actually go to him and ask him that whether he had lunch and whether everything was okay and all that. So, you know, it just, that awareness has to be there. And it's very simple if we are aware. But when we are not aware, if somebody shouts at us or if something happens to us, we go into either reaction mode or we go into pain.
Okay.
So if we keep that in mind, that the other person, it's a preconditioning that he has. He can't see his natural acceptance. But if I can see my natural acceptance, it will not disturb me now. You see what I mean?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
But if you want to give someone a resolution, you said you had some parents and some family coming. If you want to, someone voluntary, are they willing to change if these things come out?
Yeah, we'll come to that also. That will happen once they have trust in you.
Okay.
Once they have trust on your intention.
Okay.
We'll come to that in the next few slides. We'll come to that.
Yeah. Thanks a lot, ma'am. Thank you.
Welcome. So we'll move forward. So this is the common mistake that's happening in relationship, that when I evaluate myself, I'm evaluating on the basis of my intention. But when I'm evaluating the other person, I'm evaluating on the basis of their competence. And then this doubt in competence, or this, you know, what I can see that their ability is not there, that question mark from there, I'm putting it in the intention. I start doubting their intention based on their competence. So then I get irritated, I get angry, I have this feeling of opposition, and I may not speak to the other person for a long time. It might break up the relationship. One may lose a lot of friends like this. So this doubt on intention, this is the major reason for the problem in relationship. And here, this doubt on intention stems from whatever I have decided. And you can see this is to do with preconditionings. When I cannot see that, you know, if my natural acceptance is pure, the other's natural acceptance is also pure. So I already have this feeling of opposition. I'm assuming something about the other. So that's like a preconditioning in me. So that is the cause for the problem. So you can see in this, what we have put up, the yellow part is the natural acceptance. That is the intention. The red part is the imagination that has come from preconditioning. So when I have this imagination, when I have these thoughts going on in me about something that I have assumed about the other, then it is a preconditioning. It's not based on my natural acceptance. But when I can see, if I am aware of my natural acceptance, then I can see that the other also has the same natural acceptance as me. And then this doubt on intention will not come. Then I can see that just like my intention, the other's intention is also pure. The problem is only in the competence. And then we look at how we can deal with that. So if you have unconditional, continuous trust on intention, that means trust on the, when you are able to see the natural acceptance of the other, and if the other is lacking in competence, what would you do? Would you try to improve the other person's competence and also improve your own? Or will you get irritated, angry, and have a feeling of opposition for the other? So if you have unconditional, continuous trust, meaning all the time you have continuously trust on intention of the other person, and it is unconditional, regardless of the other person's behavior, then what will you do? The other may not be able to do what you expect, but then we have trust on the other person's intention, then are we going to try to help them? Are we going to try to improve their competence and maybe our own competence if it's lacking? Or will we get irritated and angry and have this feeling of opposition?
Good afternoon, ma'am. Shivani here.
Yeah.
From now on, ma'am, I'm launching the reflections.
Okay.
And meanwhile, can we take some questions from the participants?
Ah, sure. At least sure. While this poll is there, this reflection is there.
Dr. R. Karthikeyan, kindly.
Yes. Yes. Good morning, ma'am. This is Karthikeyan. The story of two, which you said, is so nice, ma'am. It is actually the practical experience everyone feels of their life.
Yes.
So what is actually the question? Even people are finding some problems at their family to correct it to. The people are not ready to accept their truth at their family. How you are going to implement the entire society has to believe in the aspect of trust, ma'am? How you are going to make it?
Excuse me, what is the question exactly?
Yeah, we are unable to make the family to be making on trust, ma'am. We have some problems with the family.
So,
how we are going to make the entire society to be coming in under one umbrella, ma'am?
Yes. So where do we start from? So the starting point is ourselves. So first we have to see ourselves. We have to see whether we can have trust on intention of the other, and we'll see how that makes a difference and how it impacts. We'll just come to that in the next slide or so.
Sure.
Okay. To that. How the other person will start listening, or how the other person will start getting affected. But the focus to start with needs to be with ourselves. So I'll come to that. Right?
Thank you.
In the next couple of slides. Thank you. Yeah. So mostly everybody can see that we should try to improve our competence and their competence and not get annoyed and irritated. So when we are trying to improve the other's competence and also our own, that really is trust on intention. And when we have trust on the other person's intention, then we respond. We don't react. But when we doubt the intention, that's when we react. So like I said, if somebody shouts at you, right? What is your first thing? Are you going to respond or are you going to react? So if somebody shouts at me, generally what happens, one person shouts at the other. Supposing somebody shouts at me, I get hurt. Either I go into pain and I start sulking that why did this person say this? Or if I'm more aggressive, I might shout back. So that is like a reaction. That is, somebody else did not have awareness. Somebody else made some mistake. I'm doing the same thing. But if I can see the other person's intention, if I can see when does somebody shout, when does a mother beat her child, when she is feeling comfortable inside or uncomfortable inside. So obviously if the mother is comfortable, she is not going to beat her child or scold her child. When she is comfortable inside, she will not do that. But when she is herself distressed, when she is herself in pain, when she is herself in problem, only then she will react that way with the child. So you can only give what you have, like I said. So if you are unhappy, you cannot give happiness to the other. So if I can see that, and I can see that the other person is actually in pain, then I stop having this feeling of opposition. Then I don't shout at them back. Then I don't go into pain. Then I start responding. Then I start thinking how I can help them. See the difference in the perspective? What happens? Like I'll give you one example of a lady who was going through, a teacher who was going through these workshops, and she gave this personal example that, she was at home in the evening after attending the workshop during the day, and she came home, she was cooking in the kitchen, and her two children, one was maybe 7-8 years, the other one was smaller, like maybe 4 years, they were playing in the living room. They were playing with a ball and bat. It was dark, so they couldn't play outside. So they were playing inside the house. And while playing, this ball went and hit the window pane and it broke. So she said, out of habit, you know, she just rushed out in anger that, you know, they've broken this. But then while walking towards them, she just remembered this trust and reaction and response. And by the time she reached them, she had calmed down and she just quietly asked them to move aside so they don't get hurt with the glass. And she took a broom and started collecting all the pieces of glass on one side and picking them up without saying a word to them. So the children were very surprised because this was something new, you know, they were not used to this behavior. So the elder one said, "Mummy, marogi nahi," meaning you're not going to hit us. And the younger one said very softly, "No, no, she's attending workshop these days. She's not getting angry." So you see the difference? It is a change that one can create for oneself. Either one can respond or one can react. It just needs a little bit of awareness. So we have one more reflection for you to answer. How many persons in your family and friends do you have trust on intention? That is on natural acceptance, which is continuous. So that means it is unconditional and continuous. That means you never ever get irritated, angry, or have a feeling of opposition. I would say, you know, think about this carefully and answer. How many people do you really have this trust on intention where you don't ever, ever get angry with them? You don't ever have a feeling of opposition. You're totally in harmony. It's a difficult question because, you know, we are so used to sort of seeing whatever comes at us and giving that back to the person in front of us. Like I mentioned that example of, you know, having a bad day at work and coming and blurting it out on the family at home. So, we need to explore this for ourselves. And meanwhile, if there's any question, I can take that question related to content that we have covered so far.
Dr. V. Vandana, ma'am.
Ma'am, I have a small doubt now.
Yeah.
Suppose if we are going to be, like, if we are not getting irritated, if we are not getting angry, mm-hmm. or if we don't oppose whatever people are doing, mm-hmm. will they not take us for granted?
Yeah, actually, that's a misconception, you know. Okay. I can give you my own example. There was a time when at work, I used to be very particular that, you know, things have to be done properly in the office and, you know, the weighing machine needs to be in my room and things, you know, okay. need to be in order and all that. Mm. Now, you can do the same thing either by getting angry with the person or you can do it in a nice, friendly way. Either way, what happens is, if it's not going to happen, it won't happen. But if you look at, you know, any of the major leaders that are liked by their subordinates, then you will find that it is those who are not dominating and not the type who get annoyed and angry. Besides, if you look at your natural acceptance, your natural acceptance is to be in harmony. When you get annoyed and irritated, we spoke about it yesterday, you know, what does it do to your health? When you are in disharmony, you are impacting your own body first, even before it reaches the other. So you might get annoyed and angry at the person and shout at them one time. But each time you go through that experience again and again in your mind, you're hurting yourself because you're, you know, having that experience, you're reliving those emotions again and again, those negative emotions. So it is impacting your own body. The other person is done and gone, you know. Do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah. But it also depends on the people.
Excuse me?
It also depends on the people whom we work with. Am I right?
Yeah, it depends on the people we work with. But
sometimes
then what about us?
Granted, yeah.
But what about us?
Yeah.
Now
yeah.
See, like, for instance, in the example that I gave of myself coming home, Now, I'm going to do the work anyway, right? I am going to do what I think is necessary for my family. I will go and work. My patients may come late and I may have to come home and do this before I have lunch. So this may happen again and again. So really speaking, where is my choice? My choice is either not to do it or to do it willingly or to do it grudgingly. But I have already chosen to do it. Now I'm only left with two choices. Either I do it in a pleasant way without hurting myself or anybody else, or I do it in an unpleasant way where I may cause unhappiness to somebody else and I will definitely cause unhappiness to myself. So the choice is very clear once I see that.
You are right. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Got it. Thank you. Okay. So we can see that most people have some trust on intention on few people. And this is very important. So, you know, just do it sincerely. And sometimes there could be people who may not have even one person because we tend to shout or get angry easily. But this is where that trust on intention comes in. And if we keep exploring this, it will help us become, you know, more responsible and be able to respond rather than to react to situations and people around us. And that's when, you know, you can see that your stress level will go down. You will not have problems related to stress. Yeah, so going forward, this is the fundamental thing that we need to do for having a relationship. This trust on intention, that is the foundation of relationship. So from this exploration, you can get an idea. And once you have trust on intention on the other person, then this question mark that we had on 4A, we can now tick it and say, now we are able to see that the other does want to make me happy. If I want to make the other happy, then the other also wants to make me happy. Consider the other to be standing in front of you. So if I ask you, you want to make the other person happy, you say yes. Now you see from the other person's perspective. We ask the other person, do you want to make this person happy? Meaning you. Then the other person also will say that, yes, I want to make the other happy. So now there is a tick mark. If I can see from the other's perspective, if I can see that my intention and the other's intention is the same. And then when I evaluate on the basis of our ability, I will evaluate myself on my ability and I will evaluate the other on their ability. So, you know, it will not be that I evaluate my intention and the other's competence. Now I will see my competence and I will see the other's competence. And I can see that we all have different levels of competence. So while our intention is pure, every person has the same intention. This green block in different cells, this green block is the competence. So you can see this level of competence can be different in different cells. And the red part is the lack of competence. So this is really the major takeaway, that the intention or the natural acceptance of all is the same. We are different only in our competence. So what to do about this? So at least now I can say, when I say for myself, the glass broke by accident, I can also say for the other person that it broke by accident. And if the other person makes the same mistake even 100 times, I should be clear about his intention. I know that the person has made the mistake due to a lack of competence. It's not a lack of intention. So once I see that, then I will start making an effort to help improve the other person's competence. How will I do that? Only if I have a feeling of affection. If I have a feeling of opposition, I'm really not going to be able to help the other person. Even if I try to superficially help improve the other person. But at the root inside, if I have this feeling of opposition, it's not going to work. So first of all, I have to have a feeling of affection for the other person. Only then can I help them improve. And I know that he may have difficulty understanding. It's also true that I may not have explained properly. It may be that the other person has not understood because of something that I didn't say properly. I can look at my competence also at the same time. Similarly, when I'm seeing for myself, when of course I'm clear about my intention when I make a mistake, But I know that the mistake is due to lack of competence. It's not a lack of intention. So I can make an effort to improve my own competence. Only then can I help the other person. So first of all, I have to work on myself. I have to improve my own competence. I should be willing to learn. I should be willing to see that I also make mistakes and see how I can correct them. And once this trust on intention is there, then that's the starting point for the development of both people to move forward in the relationship. So we'll take that reflection here. The other makes mistakes because he or she is lacking in competence, that is not living in accordance with his or her natural acceptance, or is lacking in skills, or is like that, cannot change, or does it intentionally. And when I'm looking at myself, I make mistakes because I am lacking in competence. I'm not living in accordance with the natural acceptance, or I am lacking skills, or I'm like that only, cannot change, or intentional. So you can see, any questions meanwhile, we can take them up while we are reflecting on this.
Dr. R. Ganga Guru.
Yes, madam. No, good morning, madam.
Morning.
I want to share one thing in this session, madam. Yesterday I did one search on internet. I got one data. They did survey by International Society of Psychology at USA. They did survey around 10 years, more than 2 lakhs people. They had only one question, when you are happy. They got database, 60% of people told whom we are living. 30% of people told when, where we are working. 5% people told because of money. That's only your content is mainly focusing on whom we are living. That's only I want to convey this session. Thank you, madam.
Thank you.
That's only the 60% only deciding we are happy. That is the main focus on our family and other relations is most important, madam.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So, thank you. So we can see that the other makes mistakes because they are lacking in competence. And I am also lacking in competence. Yeah. So what to do? Both are lacking in competence. Then how to go forward? So of course, now once we have trust on intention, now we can put a tick mark on the 4A and say that yes, the other wants to make me happy. But when I am evaluating the competence of the other and I'm evaluating my competence, remember we said we may be differing in competence. So when I make a program or make a plan of action with this, you know, when I interact with the other person, I will evaluate the other person's competence as well as my competence. And then accordingly, I will make the plan. So what will I do? I will make effort to learn from the other. If I am lacking in competence, I will learn from the other, improve my competence. If the other is lacking in competence, then I will try to help the other improve his competence without becoming irritated. So that's how we can move forward and mutually develop. This is what we said. So you can see now. I can see that my natural acceptance is to be happy and make others happy, or I can see that the natural acceptance of the other in my family and friends. I can see that my natural acceptance is to be happy and make others happy. This thing is not complete, no? This question. I can see that my natural acceptance is to be happy and make others happy. I can also see that the natural acceptance of the other is the same as mine or is different from me. Yeah. Am I able to see that the other person's natural acceptance, at least in my family and friends, is the same as mine, or do I think that it is different from my natural acceptance? Am I able to see that? Is our natural acceptance the same or is it different? What do you feel?
Meanwhile, ma'am, Professor Dr. D. Nisar.
Yes, madam.
Please go ahead. You have a question on trust?
Madam, trust is very important, madam. But everybody has to believe in it. But many people are not having trust. Even among the spouses also, they don't have trust with each other. How to build up the trust among the spouses? Because in youngsters and all, after getting married and all, they don't believe each other. They have got all doubts. They don't have trust and all. So that is my question. How to address this problem, madam? Because youngsters, we got so many problems we are hearing. They don't trust each other. They don't they don't mutually respect each other and all.
Yeah, so I'll answer that. Yeah.
Family members. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Yeah, so we'll just finish this reflection. So people are able to see that others' intention is same as mine. That's good. Now, you know, how to get others to have trust? So first of all, do I have trust? Does it work for me? So am I in harmony? So, you know, somebody had this question, how do we get others to change? How will the other change? So if I have trust on intention, then it will reflect in my behavior, right? So even within the family, if I myself am not behaving a certain way, if I myself am not showing that I have trust on the other's intention, then no matter what I try to do to try to help the other to change, the other will not change because they can see that my behavior is not really exemplary myself. So like this, you know, there was this girl who was going through this process of trust and all, and she came home one day with she had some sports, one of the students, she was going through these workshops and she was very impressed with this trust. And one day she went home from school, she had some sports event and she won a trophy, and she went home and kept that trophy on the kitchen table. Her mother was cooking in the kitchen and she was trying to explain to her mother how good this whole workshop is. And she was trying to explain about trust and how well it was explained about intention and competence and how she can change so many people, and her mother should also listen to this and so on. Suddenly her brother, who was playing outside, he came running in and he banged into the trophy, and that trophy fell down and broke. And this girl started shouting at her brother. And the mother just quietly looked at her and then said, "What happened to your intention and competence now?" So see, we want to change the other person, but are we showing it also in our behavior? And it will come in our behavior only when we live by it. So when we live by it means we have to explore first ourselves, behave in such a way that the other gets assured of my behavior. So if this girl had instead been able to follow what she was talking about and not gotten angry with her mother, with her brother, then her mother may have felt like also attending the workshop and also listening to what has made her daughter change, you see. So there are people who explore and they will become better human beings, be able to see this trust on intention of other people. But then there will be people who will just take this as information and try to change other people. So it may not work unless we are ourselves motivated to, you know, make a change in ourselves. And ultimately, at least if I have this feeling of trust, like I explained, you know, what I could experience myself, if I have this feeling of trust, then I am at ease. I am more comfortable inside myself. I am in harmony. So whether I have changed the other or not, the first impact it has is that I myself am happy. So if we can see that, then we can move forward, and the other person will also be more willing to listen to us or more willing to change. So we have this thing that you can think about, and you can, list the members in your family and ask these 8 8 questions regarding trust for each person, and then you evaluate. You can talk to them if you like, but list all the members, and for each person separately, you ask these questions. And you can involve the people at home. You can talk to them. You can get them also to do this exercise. And you see what comes of it. And you can see, you know, we tend to see things from our perspective, but we need to look at things from the other's perspective also. So while we want the others to change, it may be that the others in the house also want us to change in some ways. So, you know, let's keep an open mind. Let's try to evaluate. It's all, you know, there is no test in this. There is no marking, grading. We are our judges ourselves. We are just exploring to become better human beings. That's all. And in the process, we are going to be the ones who will be happy also. And once we are able to have this change in behavior, then the other person will naturally come and take our opinion. Naturally, they will want to listen to us. Once they are assured in this relationship, only then will they be able to, you know, listen or change. So for anybody else to change, first it should reflect in my behavior. That is important. So I'll quickly sum up. We have gone over time. Trust is to have the clarity that the other wants to make me happy and prosperous. This is the basic foundation of relationship. And if I have trust on intention, I feel related to the other person. I make a program with the other based on the right evaluation of our mutual competence, the other's competence as well as my competence. So if the other person is lacking in competence, then I can make effort to assure the other. How will I assure the other? By showing in my behavior so that the other person feels that, yes, this is true for me. Then I make effort to improve the competence of the other once the other is assured in relationship and not before that. Because if I try to change the other person and I myself have not really imbibed this, I myself am not really showing this in my behavior, then the other person is not assured and the other person will not listen. So that is if the other is lacking in competence. Of course, if the other person has more competence than me, then I should be ready to take help from the other person to improve my own competence. But wherever I have a doubt on intention, I start evaluating the other on the basis of his competence, and I assume their lack of competence to be the lack of intention. That's when the problem starts. I start feeling opposed. And, you know, I think that I am good because I am evaluating myself on my intention. And when I have this feeling of opposition, then it shows up as irritation or anger, you know. And then the relationship can't move forward because I'm trying to make the other person change and the other person is trying to make me change. So then it will just be at a standstill. So whoever has more understanding can start that process. Even if others don't change, doesn't matter. Let's start the process. And we'll find that somewhere along the line, they will change. Because see, there is so much of backlog. We may have been doing things that have been upsetting the other person for so long, we may not be aware of it. So it might take some time for the other person, but when they see that our behavior is changing, when they see that we are making an effort, when they see that we have this feeling of affection, which is unconditional for them, then slowly they come around. They will come around. There is no two ways to it. I can say with 100% guarantee they will come around. But how much time it takes depends on how much of a problem there is, you know, between the two. But things will change. But we need to make the effort first from our side. So I'll stop here. I think we are totally out of time. But, you know, any questions on trust, please keep them. And we will try to answer them in the evening as far as possible.
Yeah, just show the next slide, Didi, where that video is listed.
Ha ha, yes, yes.